Zach, sorry, but I cannot see. Do you want me to be a co-host just for safety reasons, or
Yeah, you are a co-host.
I'm a co-host?
Yes. Absolutely. Okay, so I think if everybody's ready, let's start. So welcome everybody to this Basic Notion seminar that we are having. And I'm very happy to introduce today Professor Giovanni Bellettini from University of Siena, and of course also ICTP, who will speak today about a very nice piece of differential geometry, namely the mean curvature flow of closed hypersurfaces. So the floor is yours.
So thank you a lot for the introduction. So this is a Basic Notion seminar, so I will try to be as elementary as possible and keeping the notation and the technicalities to a minimum. So let me first define what is mean curvature flow, and then I will discuss some examples. So the definition can be given in various ways. I will use the definition without parameterizations, which may be simpler. So let PT be a family of solid sets contained in Rn. So for any t, which is a parameter, which is time, et is a solid set. And solid means, say, the closure of an open set. And I say that we say that T in ET, or say T in the boundary of T, is the same. I will somehow speak about evolution of hypersurfaces, or sometimes which these hypersurfaces are boundary of something. So for T, say, in some time interval, 0 capital T, we say that this is a smooth mean curvature flow, which means that at the end, the surfaces, the hypersurface will move by mean curvature if we define the following function . So this is the distance function with the sign is negative inside the solid set and positive outside. So this is my set. This is D. This is ET at fixed time. If this function is smooth in a neighborhood, in an open set containing all the boundaries. So which means essentially that the flow as a function of time is smooth, and then also each boundary is smooth. And the following equation holds. For any time here. This is the PDE. This is the time derivative. This function is defined everywhere. Actually, it's smooth in an open set containing all boundaries. This is the gradient in Rn. This is the Laplacian in Rn. So this is, say, if you want, the heat equation, this term here equal to this, but for the distance function with the sign. And the gradient of D is the unit outward normal on the boundary. This is called mean curvature, sometimes denoted also by H, is a scalar mean curvature, and is equal to the sum of the principal curvatures. Notice that this is a PDE, which is however valid on an hypersurface, and this hypersurface is moving, okay? So this is just valid on the boundary. So this is called the normal velocity. So at the end, I'm saying that the normal velocity at each point is equal to the mean curvature vector, So which means that if I have an initial set, say initial curve, so this is the interior, this is the boundary, it means that at each point, the velocity here, the convention is that the velocity is where the curve shrinks if I am locally convex and here instead expands locally. So the evolution here, the normal velocity here must be proportional to the mean curvature here. Okay. And this must be valid at all points of the curve. Okay, why I have given this definition? Well, this definition is, you see, there are no parametrizations. This is convenient in some sense, but there are other ways to define. So this is a remark. So there is a remark here, which says that there are other ways, in particular, the flow can be defined and studied. Describing the manifolds instead that set of points using the maps, immersion or embeddings of a given manifold using parametrizations. So I will not use probably here this language, which is very convenient for at least two reasons, because it can be useful to treat immersions, not only embedding. So this means that my flowing manifold could self-intersect. I will avoid here this case, but in general, using immersions, this can be done. And another reason for which it is very convenient, because it takes advantage of the covariant differential, of the covariant language, covariant derivatives. Okay, so there are at least two ways to describe. This is maybe simpler, but maybe not always the most convenient way, actually. Okay, so why this problem? So another remark. This evolution is the fastest way to decrease area of the moving manifolds. So this means that in a sense, this flow try to evolve this curve, say, as time is moving, is going on, this tries to reduce the area of the flowing surface as fast as possible. This is not so easy to make rigorous, because typically, people say that this is the gradient flow of the area functional, which essentially would mean that this is sort of generalization of if I had a system of ordinary differential equations, this is the gradient flow of F, which goes trying to go towards a minimum of F in the fastest way. In this case, this is the analog of this, but the difficulty are several, because here we don't have, say, a vector structure, maybe. And it's very difficult also to say what does it mean gradient of the area functional. In difficult to make rigorous also what is this for F area of some surface. This can be made rigorous, and if you want to take really a rigorous way to understand this can be, for instance, obtained from an algorithm by Almgren, Taylor, and Wang in 1993, which is a sort of, which makes somehow, which gives a sense to this idea for when F is the area, and uses a sort of implicit Euler scheme for the mean curvature flow. Okay. Examples, it is always very good to have several examples here in mind. Okay, so let me give you the basic examples. First example is suppose that this is a minimal surface, which means a smooth hypersurface with zero mean curvature. So this is a static solution of mean curvature flow starting from sigma, from this itself. Because this is a zero mean curvature, so zero velocity doesn't move, it remains fixed, and this is a solution which doesn't move. Trivial example, but very interesting because it could give barriers. Example two, here, suppose that you have an initial set, which is the interior of a solid ball in a Ren. Okay. Then the solution a posteriori, I mean a solution, but at the end the solution is still given by a shrinking sphere where R of t solves where R of t is this radius here. So this sphere has constant mean curvature. So it shrinks, remains a sphere, remaining the same shape, and shrinks to a point here. You see, this is interesting because shrinking to a point can be considered an example of singularities. Of course, a singularity should be defined, but we see that this is a moment in which the curvature blows up. And this moment is when t is equal to r squared divided by 2 minus 1. So let me call this t max. So this this evolution is defined up to t max, actually r to t is from 0 to t max, actually from minus infinity to t max, but for the moment, think that we start at from R0, and then we shrink up to T max. And this T max, so if you insert the expression of the T max here, you get that, and you compute the length of the second fundamental form, which is the sum of the, in this case, they are all the same. If you compute this, this turns out to be a constant T max minus T. So this is, you compute the length of the second fundamental form, that is the square of the square root of the sum of the squares of the all curvatures, and this constant is 1 over square root of 2. In any case, you see that this blows up when T goes to the T max with a certain rate. This is an example two. Example three is cylinder. So say S1 times R. So suppose that you start from say B R0 times R, or more generally by you start from SM times RN minus 1 minus M. And so you have a cylinder, and the cylinder shrinks. This is non-compact, by the way. So this, there is a serious difference between surfaces which are compact and manifolds which are not compact. This is a non-compact case. One has to be very careful treating non-compact initial conditions. But at the end, if you have a cylinder, this shrinks, remaining a cylinder, and you have that this evolves with RT, and this RT is the same as here, and you just substitute this with M. And you get the same, so at some time there is a singularity, and what you see is sort of the cylinder collapsed to a line, to its axis. At some time, and you have for similarly a blow up of the length of the second fundamental form. There are other important examples here. Other important example, there are very many other solutions. So, example four. So these are graphs. Say on Rn minus one. So you can suppose that your initial condition is unbounded. So you have a graph over an entire graph over Rn minus one. So you are still in the non-compact case. So this is delicate, but you can at least model this using just one parabolic PDE, nonlinear PDE. And then you have with your graph initial, so the boundary of the initial condition is the graph of U0, say, given. And this can be studied, and it can be proven that under some conditions, there exists a solution, and it remains a graph. So the property of being a graph is not destroyed by the mean curvature flow. Okay, this is another geometric factor. Next examples. Next examples are given by the so-called homothetically shrinking solutions. Example five. Homothetically shrinking solutions. I don't want to enter here in the details. This is a very big subject. Let me tell you that the sphere is homothetic. Why is homothetic? Because its shape remains same up to a rescaling, and the same for the cylinder. So in general, one can try to look for special solutions of, so you have this PDE, and you look for, say, special solution with time and space maybe independent. So special solutions. Solution where specials mean which are say an homothetic of a given initial condition. This is a bit, there are several solutions. Actually, this is an important subject because understanding, let me tell you one thing. So understanding how these solutions is strictly related on how this singularize. I have to define what does it mean, but I as t that goes to t max in some sense. So this is for the moment not rigorous because I have not defined what is the max yet. I have not tell you that there are singularities, but let me just point out that the study of these special homothetically shrinking solutions is interesting by itself, and also because it gives you information on how possible singularities may form for time slightly smaller than capital than T max. For instance, here this shrinks to a point like a sphere, this shrinks to a line, etc. In particular, there is an interesting solution here. Interesting solution. Self-similar shrinking, which is called the Angenent torus, which is sort of, so you have your, this is your, the solid torus is your smooth initial condition, and there is a special torus which remains, which is has the same shape, and it shrinks, remaining a torus. Okay. Notice that for fat torus somehow, or a torus of this sort, one can imagine that here maybe the torus is so fat that this hole maybe closes before that the torus disappears at all. So maybe at some time there should be something strange here around this point. And for a thin torus, one could expect that instead here, you see, thin torus means that here the mean curvature is very, very high toward the inside. And so this means that one can expect a normal velocity very quick toward the inside. So one could expect that before, if the torus is long but thin, one could expect that this torus could collapse somehow to a curve here before disappearing. Okay, so all these kind of studies related to this could be related also to this problem here. So let me tell you now some result here. So the first theorem, obviously, which is non-trivial at all, is the local existence. So say if is smooth and compact, then there exists a unique mean curvature flow starting from this initial condition, this smooth mean curvature flow, starting from this initial condition. So for some positive time, and actually, we can say also that we can arrange things so that there exists a maximal on a maximal time interval. Maximal here means that you cannot go on after T max. You're not smooth anymore. I will be more precise in a minute what happens to the second fundamental form as when I go to T max. But this at least allows to start the flow. So we are sure that there is a unique solution, smooth up to some maximal time. Okay. This theorem is non-trivial. The first proof maybe is, I don't know, but I think it's Gage Hamilton 86. Then there is a proof by Evans Brack using a completely different proof, a completely different language in 92. Then there is another proof by Huisken and Polden, I think. Okay, so this is the first local in time existence result. Let me tell you a remarkable property of this flow. which I will try to describe. Remarkable property of comparison property. So comparison. So theorem. Two. Suppose that you have an initial solid set smooth with bound, say compact, with the compact boundary. Suppose that E1 and E2. Two smooth initial solid sets, so one inside the other. Say one is this, which is inside that big sphere. I don't know. So this is E1 at the initial time. This is E2 solid sets, one inside the other. And then take their unique mean curvature flow, E1t and E2t. The unique smooth mean curvature flow for some common time of existence. Okay, say call it zero capital T. So for all these times, T is capital T is positive, this is smooth, it starts from E1, this is smooth and starts from E2. They are uniquely defined by this previous theorem one. Okay, then if initially one is inside the other, the same is preserved for all times. This is actually a very strong and important comparison principle. It's an important tool. And it's called a comparison principle. So let me try to tell you why this should be expected to be true. I will not do a proof because there is no time enough, but I can at least tell you something which could suggest why this is true. So let me draw a simple picture. Suppose that we are in the case of the plane, so we have E1, and we have, say, E2. And E1, initially, at time zero, is contained in E2. Now, suppose for simplicity that the boundary of D1 is at the positive distance from the boundary of E2, just for simplicity. So we are not actually in this picture, but we have, say, something like this. Okay, so E1 and E2, for simplicity. Now, these are two compact curves, closed curves, and so there are at least a pair, maybe many pairs, but in this picture, just probably one pair, which minimize the distance between the two boundaries along the flow. So suppose this is E1t, E2t, for they are one, initially they are one strictly inside the other, the flow is smooth, so for small time they are of course still one inside the other, but what happens for larger times? So take a couple of points here, which realize the minimal distance between the boundary of, so let me call T of t, distance, so this d of t is the distance, so it may be realized by several pairs. Here in this picture, we have just two pairs probably. And the idea is to show that actually a statement stronger than this, so not only they are remain inside, but the distance is non-decreasing. Well, the idea is to show that dt is non-decreasing. Which means that for larger times, this shrinks and this, so this quantity is maybe larger, okay. Now, we have to be careful because this is a very simple picture, but you have to imagine something more complicated with holes, a torus inside the other. So, I mean, this is just a very simplified picture. So the idea to show that this is non-increasing is to find a different, I mean, to show that the prime where it exists, supposing it exists, to show that the prime is larger or equal than zero. And one shows that if you compute the prime, I mean, it's not actually the prime because this the prime could not exist, but more or less, say, is sort of right derivative, but essentially the prime. One can show that essentially this is given by the difference. I mean, these are two points which may realize the minimal distance. It's not difficult to show that the tangent plane here and tangent plane here must be parallel. So this means that the normal is the same, parallel, they are parallel, the normal. It is possible to show that this is equal to V1 minus V2, where V1, say VI, for I equal 1, 2. So this is the difference of the two velocities. So, but this is actually H1 minus H2 because we have the evolution equation. So the velocity is equal H1 and this is equal to H2. So why this should be positive, not negative, say? Well, the idea is that you have to think that now this is a point of, this minimizes the distance. So if I make a translation here, rigid translation of this set, and I put in contact, so let me translate this rigidly and put it in contact, so they have the same normal. So actually what I see locally here around this point is this, the following situation. There is a manifold here and another one which touches. And locally, this is the largest and this is the smaller. Now, if the mean curvature is invariant under rotation and translation, so I can arrange things that this, such that this is horizontal. So this is somehow horizontal, this point. And then if I compute the mean curvature at a point where I'm locally the graph, horizontal graph like this, I compute the curvature here, the mean curvature turns out to be the Laplacian of the function which described locally this as a graph. So at the end, I have Laplacian of U1 minus Laplacian of U2. This only at the points where I am, where the tangent plane is horizontal. And then this is a local, I mean, if I take the difference, this is the Laplacian of the difference, and this is a local minimum, and it's immediate to check that using minimality for a function, the Hessian should be non-negative definite, and you are done. So this shows that, this should be expected. This is not the proof, but maybe the idea of the proof. The idea at the end is that we can compare the mean curvature of the set with the mean curvature of another set which is inside at the contact point. Okay, so this is an important thing. And then let me tell you, first, remarkable, I would say, and difficult theorem. Which I split into two because historically it splits into two. So let me tell you theorem 3. This is gauge Hamilton. X. So suppose that you are in two dimensions. So this is curvature flow of curves. Suppose that you have a convex, say smooth. Suppose that this is smooth and convex and bounded. And then its evolution flow exists, remains convex for all time up to T max, and at T max, the curve shrinks curve shrinks to a point. So nothing can happen before then shrinking to a point, like in the case of the sphere, the curve shrinks to a point, and once rescaled, it is close to a circle. So this means that if I start from a convex curve, what I see, of course the evolution is not explicit, so, but it remains convex, there is a magic point where it must shrink, so nothing strange happens before, and here, what I really see is sort of almost a circle which shrinks. And the circle is, remember, is a self-similar solution. Okay. This theorem has been improved by a remarkable theorem by Grayson. Now, I don't remember exactly the year, some year later. Grayson, who showed that actually Grayson was able to remove this assumption. So he removes this assumption. Suppose that now your curve is compact and smooth, but not convex. So this means that my initial curve can be very embedded, of course, but very embedded. Sorry, maybe this picture makes not so clear. It is embedded. Okay. So this is zero. So what happens here is able to show that it remains smooth. Oh, of course, the max is finite. All these cases are. So it remains smooth. And at some time, at some t, this is becoming convex. And so, once it becomes convex, we are in the previous case. So he's able to prove, a global existence theorem in the sense that if I start for any smooth, compact, embedded curve, this doesn't do any nasty thing. I mean, it remains smooth. At some moment, it becomes convex. Then it remains convex. Then it shrinks to a point, becoming, once rescaled, the circle. This is really remarkable because you see, you can imagine that the curve can be initially pass very close to itself, even if not self-intersecting, but can pass very close to itself. But still, and one could imagine that at some moment there could be self-intersections, and this cannot happen by the theorem of Grayson. So, it is embedded, it remains embedded, nothing strange happens, and this is the first. Now, for this theorem, there are more than one proofs. So, more than one proof, there is what, the original proof of Grayson, then there is a proof by Huisken, which for proving this passes through some classification of singularities. So also this proof is difficult. I mean, in some sense, also this is not easy at all. And then there is a more simple proof, I think, by Ben Andrews. Or another proof. Okay, now let me tell you another remarkable theorem here. Another remarkable theorem. So this is what concerns, so you see in two dimensions for curves, actually, singularity is the singularity of the sphere, of the circle, in some sense. To see more complicated singularities in the plane, one should start with immersed and not embedded curves. So one should start with something like this, say, or something like this. Of course, if I want to flow this, I have to abandon the distance function. I should go into the language of parametrizations, looking at the maps. This is not a singular point anymore for the map. And it can be proven, this has been done by Angenent, that this is so small, if you arrange things that this is sufficiently small, then it shrinks very quickly and forms a cusp and another kind of singularity. But I cannot discuss this here. Second theorem, remarkable theorem, the theorem 4. This is Wisken 1984. Now suppose that I am in larger dimension, and suppose that by initial boundary my solid set is smooth and smooth, and strictly convex. And then again, the flow exists is smooth, strictly convex. And again, it leaves up to some T max. And after rescaling again, properly scaling, which means that one keeps the area of the boundary constant, essentially here. After rescaling, it approaches to the, it's very close to the, to a, to the ball, radius one. So again, what we see here, we start from a convex set, convex body, say. The theorem of Wisken says that this shrinks, it remains convex, it does not do anything strange, and at some moment there is singularity time. Now the proof of this is different. Of course, a strictly convex body surface is also mean convex. Clearly, not only, I mean, strictly convex is much more than this. And to show that this condition is preserved is not difficult. So if I start under this condition to show that this is preserved is not difficult because it follows by some evolution equation. Some evolution equation for the mean curvature itself. And using this parabolic PDE, this is sort of Laplace, this is called the Laplace-Beltrami operator on the moving manifold. But in any case, it's a sort of heat equation for the mean curvature plus a nasty sort of term here. Okay. But it's much more difficult to show that strictly convexity is preserved because this is the positive definiteness of the second fundamental form. Not only its trace should remain positive, but all the second fundamental form should remain a positive definite. So to show that, that the second fundamental form remains positive definite, this is more delicate. One has to show, one has first of all to find the evolution equation for the all elements of the second fundamental form, which is a sort, again, is a sort of, something like this. Then there is minus A. Sort of equation like this. So not only one has to find this, which is been done by Wisken, but also one possible way to prove is then once you have the PDE solved by the second fundamental form and all covariant derivative of the second fundamental form, you have to show that you have to implement the maximum principle for tensors. By Hamilton. This is one possible proof. So it requires a lot of work. It's Wisken 1984, yes. So these are various remarkable theorems. And now let me show you that the singularities in general appears. Singularity can appear. So let me tell you an example, convincing example. which has been proved in various ways. Now I tell you the idea. So this is an example due to Grayson. Okay. So you see, we start from a convex object. This does not singularize in the sense that it singularizes at T-max, but at T-max also the surface disappears. So it's a sort of not too complicated singularity. And the same for curves, even if they are not embedded, but not convex initially. But now Grayson argued that suppose that you have, say, in three dimensions, suppose that you have a sort of dumbbell where here this neck is very, very thin. So here the mean curvature is very, very positive. Here is positive, but maybe not large. So they have two balls, essentially, almost, joined by a long and thin neck. So, and the idea of Grayson was the following, was that I want to show that this forms a singularity. What could it mean, this? Well, I could show that there is some time. At some positive time, then let me call T max. At T max, one possible way to say this is that say the Lyminf as T grows to T max of the volume of the solid set. So this evolves in some way. But if I arrange things to be this very long and to be this very large, this very long and this very large, maybe he's able to prove that at the max, the surface is not disappearing. Something remains in the sense that the volume inside is positive. And the idea is the following. The idea is that here I can put a big sphere somehow inside. And this sphere evolves with its evolution law. And we know by comparison that as soon as the flow is smooth, the sphere and of the object outside the dumbbell, this must remain inside. So it cannot happen. I mean, this dumbbell must leave for a time sufficient enough that this is still living. On the other hand, I can put, well, here, there is some argument different from Grayson. Here I could put, say, an Angenen torus around here. Okay. So I surround the neck with the torus, the Angenen torus, which I know that it shrinks to something, but maybe to a point, but it does not singularize before and he has some time. So if I arrange things so that this neck must remain inside the hole of the torus as soon as everything is smooth. And so now you can morally, intuitively believe that this takes some time to shrink. And if these balls are sufficiently large, they take more time to shrink. And so this cannot disappear. And so what happens here is that at the end, there should be some singularity before. So at T max, before that the whole dumbbell has disappeared. And this can be made rigorous in various ways. And it's been done by Grayson himself. So singularities appear. Okay. So there is an interesting theorem here. Theorem by Wisken. Theorem, I don't, maybe five or six, five. And suppose that this is smooth compact. Then we can detect somehow T max in the sense, so T max is maximal time of. Of existence, then the limit P converges to T max of the an infinity norm of the second fundamental form of the manifold blows up. So we can detect T max in the sense that at T max necessarily something strange happens in the sense that if I compute the sum of the square of the principal curvatures, then as soon as T converges to T max from the left, this sum blows up. So and this is quite, I mean, it's not easy at all. I mean, it's not an easy proof. It inspects the various PDEs solved by the, in a sense, why this should be true? Well, if the second fundamental form does not blow up, if say remains bounded, somehow it is possible to show that not only it remains bounded, but also all covariant derivatives also remain bounded in the same interval. And then once you know that all derivatives of the second fundamental form remain bounded, it is possible to take the limit of the manifold as T goes to T max. You can go take the limit of the manifold. You have a limit manifold. This requires some work, but there is a limit manifold from which you can restart the flow. You can restart the flow. After start the flow, on a small time interval, T max, say T max plus delta, for some positive delta, and then this contradicts the definition of T max, which was the maximal time of existence. So, and indeed, I mean, this is a starting point. I mean, then the story goes on a lot, still a big work by Wisken and others, but so the rate, say the rate of blow up, the rate of, so how, quickly, the norm of the second fundamental form one looks at the rate of blow up of this, the length of the second fundamental form as T goes to T max, and then this through the allows to start the study of singularity formation, like in the dumbbell, the Grayson example of the dumbbell, study of singularity formation. Allows, together with the so-called Wisken, with the Wisken monotonicity formula, cannot tell you what it is now, but these two ingredients to start the study of singularity formation and try to classify how singularities look like, how and their relation with the homothetically shrinking special solutions that we have discussed in example 3 or 4. Okay, so now this is a very interesting subject. Let me tell you now, I have 3 minutes, so I just conclude by saying that singularities are maybe the most interesting phenomenon here. So, but in singularity, here, one has to invent the notions of weak solutions, which means that solutions which are global defined in time, so they go beyond the first singularity time, maybe also this after the second singularity time, etc. So they are globally defined. Look for weak solutions, so-called weak solutions, globally defined, also in the presence of a singularity, so where the mean curvature is not defined, pointwise, say, for instance, globally defined for all times. Okay. And of course, coinciding with the smooth solution, as long smooth solution, as long as it exists. So there is a sort of extension of notion of flow, which for times before the Tmax is of course the same as the classical flow, but after Tmax it is still defined and it goes on, the process goes on. And of course, I mean, this is another subject which is quite huge. Try so there are, I think, at least maybe 8, 9, or maybe also 10 different notions of weak solutions. Weak solutions. The first one was given by Bracke, historically. The first one is given by Bracke. 78. So the subject of it's an interesting thing probably is to study how this the property of this weak solution and how these solutions are related one each other, because they do not coincide in general after the formation of singularities. So how do they relate each other? Are they unique? I mean, and so sort of things like this. Okay, I think that my time is over, and thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much for an excellent talk. It was very interesting and also very nice to see an actual Blackboard talk, the first time for me in a few months. So let's see if there are any questions. You can write either in the chat or you can raise your hand in the participant list and I will call upon you one by one. So let's see. There are any questions? Okay, so
I have a question.
Yeah, okay, so we have a question. So Shah Faisal, yes, you're welcome to ask your question, please.
So in the initial remark about the torus, the depending on the initial picture of the torus, the genus of the torus can disappear. So what happens to the genus of a general genus G surface?
What happens in general to a genus of the, no, this I don't know what happens in general to a genus. I don't know, I think, well, of course you, again, you need the notion of weak solution. Because if you imagine that the holes now disappear, in a sense that if you have a fat torus, say, then this singularizes at some moment here. And then maybe after, now here you need the notion of weak solutions because you want to go on in order to answer to your question. So what happens? Depending on which solution you choose, maybe, okay, this becomes a sphere and then it shrinks. So I think that here you need the notion of solution. This, so in general, I cannot tell you, maybe there is a study on this, but I'm not completely sure. So a study by Brian White, which I don't remember now the results, but as far as I know, maybe it's Brian White which studied the partially maybe this problem. But of course, you have to select the notion of a solution. So for this, maybe he was using sort of Ilmanen set theoretic solution or also viscosity solutions, maybe. But more, I cannot tell you more than that.
Right. A second question. You define this destined function, I think, in theorem 3. Can you please draw some picture to show that it is not, in general, smooth?
Yes, the distance function has a sign. In general, the distance function from a manifold, of course, is not smooth exactly on the boundary of the manifold. And this is a problem, no? So if you take just the distance, of the point, so f of tx, just the distance, then this is, of course, say you have this curve here, so this positive here, this zero here. But the point is that I want a PD exactly on this manifold here where this distance is not differentiable, you see, because locally, here what you see locally, here you're positive, and locally you have a corner, the graph of D is exactly a corner on your curve. So exactly there where I want to have a PD, exactly on the moving manifold, the distance is not smooth. But now, so this is no, I cannot use it, but now suppose that this part here, I make it negative. Okay, I make it negative. This means that instead of having a distance positive everywhere, I have negative, positive and zero. And now it is possible to show that here in the neighborhood of the curve, this sine distance function, which is now positive and negative and zero on the manifold is smooth, smooth enough in a sense that the smoothness of a manifold here is equivalent to say that this distance function now with a sign so you see when I am inside this is zero so the distance is negative when I am outside this is zero so the distance is positive it is zero on the boundary so it is possible to show that a manifold is smooth if and only if this function here, now fixed t, take a fixed t for a moment, there is a neighborhood of your boundary in which this is smooth. So this is equivalent. So this is essentially a way to describe your manifold without parametrization, just as a level set, a single level set of a single function globally. And this function is very, very nice because it's a distance function. So where it is smooth, so in the neighborhood of the manifold, you have the Aikonal equation. And so this Aikonal equation is essentially a way to extend the normal vector field, keeping length one, not only on the manifold, but also in a small neighborhood. And once you have this extension of the normal vector field in an open neighborhood, all curvature invariants, all curvatures can be described instead of using parametrization, using the derivative of this distance function. For instance, this is equal to, this is a theorem. So on the boundary, the mean curvature is the Laplacian, and the advantage of this, that this Laplacian is a standard Laplacian in Rn. So what do you do? You do the Laplacian in an open neighborhood and then you restrict on the manifold and the restriction is equal to this h and so on. As Second fundamental form can be described by the Hessian of the distance, etc., etc.
Right, thank you.
Okay, thank you. So there are two other people who have questions. So the first question is from Zog Gantumov. So if you can unmute, please, and ask your question. Let's see if he's here. Okay, otherwise maybe we wait with that and I will let Hamza, our own diploma student, Hamza Unisli, ask the question, please.
Okay, thank you for the talk. Can you hear me?
Yes, sure.
Okay. So my question is whether these results obtained are considered only for manifolds embedded in the Euclidean space, or the results are still valid when changing the metric. And the second question is, in this case, whether changing the whether there is a surface of R3 that may shrink to a singularity for a specific metric, but not for another one. I mean, whether changing the metric may let us avoid singularities somewhat.
Okay, what I know is that so first of all, differential geometers usually do not use the distance function. They prefer to use parametrizations. So they look at the whole map instead of just at the image of points. but this is an advantage that they can treat also the self-intersected case. The mean curvature flow has been studied by Wisken and others, also sitting in a Riemannian manifold. So there are whole literature short time existence, singularity time, T max, etc., also in a Riemannian manifold. And of course, maybe it could happen. I mean, it's not necessarily true that maybe you should disappear in finite time, because maybe it could probably happen that you go toward a sort of geodesic. So I'm imagining that, suppose now that you flow an initial curve which is here on the boundary of this surface by mean curvature, and then you flow, and then maybe it happens that not necessarily you can shrink, you could go maybe toward a sort of geodesic curve there. So the answer at the end is yes, there is a big literature, I think, on the mean curvature flow in a Riemannian manifold in general. I don't know if I've answered to you, but...
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so did you have any more questions, Hamza, or that was it?
The second question was that whether a surface, for example, the sphere, can shrink for example, the intrinsic metric we have seen that it shrinks to a point following the associated mean curvature flow. Now, if we consider the general case, whether it depends on the choice of the metric, this fact or not. I mean, whether it's always the solution is that it shrinks to a point, or this may depend.
As I told you, this does not give you an answer. No? This is
I don't see how, I mean, in this case, we will not have the same result as before.
I mean, in general, this probably could evolve toward this and remaining here now, trapped here.
Ah, okay. I see. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so finally, going back to the question from Zog Gantumov. So the microphone is not working, but I will ask for the question instead. So the question is, does the weak solution suitably defined exist globally in time?
Yes, as I said, there are several notions of weak solutions which ranges from definition from geometric measure theory to purely PDEs, definitions. One very popular is the is viscosity solution, which is a notion of weak solution, just maybe uniformly continuous function, which is for which essentially this PDE, one studies this so this is a degenerate nonlinear PDE. So one can give a notion of weak solution, not necessarily C2, actually only Lipschitz to this PDE. Geometrically, each level set of this putative solution evolve itself by mean curvatures, not only one level set, but all together they evolve by mean curvature. So there is a big theorem here, existence. And moreover, more difficult and uniqueness of a viscosity solution for this mean curvature flow problem. And this is goes back to Evans, Chenji, Gagoto in 93, and also Evans, Sprack. No, in the year I don't remember, sorry, maybe it's 91. Evans, Sprack at the same time. Famous result. So for this notion, there is a global existence for all times, uniqueness, which is much more difficult in this case. And this gives a solution which coincides in a proper way to the classical solution as long as the classical solution exists. So it's just one example. There are actually historically Brack in 78 was the first to define a notion of weak solution completely different from this using manifold theory. So geometric measure theory is a sort of manifold theory gives another notion of solution, for which uniqueness has maybe is less, but in any case, there is another theory of weak solution. And then the story goes on. There are, as I said, starting from Bracke, passing through Chenji, Gagoto, Evans, Sprack, then Ilmanen, De Giorgi, and others give several different notions of weak solutions.
Okay, thank you. And then the same participant also had a second question, which is there a notion of mean curvature flow, say for space-like hypersurfaces in a Lorentzian manifold? So.
The Lorentzian manifold, what I know, is a sort of analog. In a Lorentzian manifold, with a Minkowski metric, say, what I know is that the analog of this problem is, in this case, now time has a different meaning. They are not anymore parabolic problems, but are more close to hyperbolic problems. And what I know is that sort of geometric similar problem is a minimal surface equal to zero, where now the mean curvature is in the Minkowski space. And time and space in they are somehow the same role. And so they speak more than like minimal surfaces in the Minkowski space rather than mean curvature flow. So the analog, as far as I see, of mean curvature flow is minimal surface, but in Minkowski space. This is what I want to say. And okay. And it is not far to some evolution law, which is not anymore velocity equal mean curvature, but is a sort of acceleration equal mean curvature times a factor, which I think, if I'm not wrong, makes the equation Lorentz invariant. But this is a way to look at. This is a mean curvature of the time slice. So this as a whole is like to say h equals zero in time space. There is a big literature on this. I think they are called classical strings.
Okay, thank you very much for that answer. So I think these were all the questions we had for now. So on that note, I would like to thank again the speaker, Professor Bellettini, for a wonderful talk, and also the camera crew, the technical staff, for making it possible. So for all the participants for being here. And so before we leave, I just want to start a small poll that before you leave, I would be grateful if you could answer. It takes just 30 seconds. And otherwise, I hope to see you next time. So thank you all.
Thanks.
Thank you, Professor Bellettini. Oh, and if you're a diploma student, you can also stay if you have some more questions. I think this is okay.